Good morning, students. So today we are going to focus on one design technique, which is actually called as the divide and conquer technique. Okay, so I am going to design, say, an algorithm using this divide and conquer technique. So after I do that, now how can I evaluate the time complexity of an algorithm, right? Using the divide and conquer, we basically we'll try to understand this concept of recurrence relations, right? So any algorithm that you wanted to design using divide and conquer approach, right, you can evaluate the time complexity of that algorithm by representing that algorithm in a form of recurrence relation, because these algorithms are going to be typically recursive algorithms. So this particular lecture is going to talk about the idea behind divide and conquer approach. And how do you call those divide and conquer approach as recursive algorithms? And talk something called as recurrence relations. That is, these recursive algorithms are going to be represented in a form of recurrence relation. And these recurrence relations are being used in order to calculate the time complexity of the algorithm. So that is going to be the focus of today's lecture, where you're learning a design technique, but to start evaluating that, right, we use a form of a recurrence relation. So our focus is going to be on calculating the time complexity of different recurrence relation, and then try applying this kind of divide and conquer approach to different kinds of problems, right? So that's going to be the focus of this particular lecture today. So let's get on with what do you mean by divide and conquer. So the idea is, as I pointed out in the first class, that the design strategy of you want to divide a larger problem into smaller problems, right, and then try to solve that problem. So that is the layman's way of telling this, but let's now try understand it more deeply. Now you want to divide an instance of problem into two or more smaller instances, right? So if you are dividing a problem into two, these two problems are going to be of the same size, and then now you take that smaller sub problem and again further keep recursively dividing this, which means that I divide a problem into two, right? I take the other sub problem and then now I further divide that into two of the same sub size. So this goes like this, and you keep doing this recursively. You keep doing this recursively meaning you keep trying to divide these problem, right, into your equal sub problems that you have depending upon the number of sub problems that you do, and you keep doing that repeatedly. So the first level is you divide into two. The next level is you take that every problem and divide again that into two. So you have four at the second stage, eight at the third stage, and you keep doing this recursively. And you keep doing this recursively till you reach a small size problem or a base case, which we call, where at that size you could solve that problem in a straightforward manner. This is called recursive relations. Right, so you're going to solve smaller instances recursively, and based on that smaller solutions that you've got, you're going to obtain the solutions for your larger problem, right? And you go on to use some type of recurrence relation. Recurrence is something related to recursive, and so you mathematically represent that using a recurrence relation. So that is the idea behind divide and conquer, right? So to graphically represent that divide and conquer approach, we generally use that in sorting algorithms. You could use that. You could also use in other problems. We will discuss that. So if you have problems like say quick sort, merge sort, which we will explain in detail later, we are dividing that into sub problems, right? And then trying to conquer and get the solutions to the sub problem and trying to combine these sub solutions to get your final solution. But the point is this now, we are now talking in terms of dividing some sub-problems into some equal size and then keep recursively doing this till you can solve that sub-problems are, of smaller size till you reach a base case, right? And from there, you try to take it to finding out the solutions for the larger problem. So what you do is you use recursive algorithms to do that, and you basically use stack data structure, which I was explaining there, in order to do a recursive call and return to the base call, right? You basically use stack implementation for these kind of recursive algorithms. But anyway, let's get on and try to understand how you could, what is this recurrence relation meaning? What is this approach of calculating the time complexity for divide and conquer based approaches? Right, so this is one case. Now, say you have a problem of size n, you're trying to divide that into sub problems of same size, and then you try to get the solution to the subproblem, solution to the subproblem 2, and then you try to take the solution to the original problem. But now when you further keep dividing this into n by 4 and n by 4, then n by 8 into n by 8, right? If your n value is 8 itself, you would have reached at point 1 now. You could then start applying and then recursively try to combine the solutions to get the solutions for the larger problem. So let's see how this really works by trying to understand what you mean by a recurrence relation, right? So any problem, if you take, can either be solved by writing it in a non-recursive way or by a recursive way of solving that problem. So recursive algorithm, what is the meaning of a recursive algorithm? Recursive algorithm is something which tries to call the same algorithm, but every time it makes a call to the same algorithm, it calls with a smaller input size, right? So that is how you call the same problem, function of the algorithm again and again, till you reach a case which is basically called as a recursive case. So in order to calculate the time complexity of that, you basically use a mathematical relation called the recurrence relation to calculate the running time of that particular algorithm, right? So recurrence relations are very, very powerful in order to calculate the time complexity of recursive algorithms. So let's take the recurrence relation. So recurrence relation is basically an equation or an inequality that goes on to describe a function in terms of its value on smaller inputs, right? Or as a function of the preceding lower term. So you're trying to calculate f of n. This depends on f of n minus 1, f of n minus 2. So you're recursively trying to call the same function smaller input size. So that's the idea. So how long you're going to keep doing that till you reach a step called the base step. The base step is something where you have the initial conditions or the base conditions, where you reach to that subproblem size, you get this from the base solution. You arrive now at calculating what is for f of n, right? Based on arriving, say, at till f of 1, and then you calculate for f of n minus 1. So you have to recursively use this till you reach the base step, right? But every time you're recursively calling a function of lower order input, you have to maintain the higher order value onto a stack prior to calling the lower order value. So that is how you go on to use stack data structure when you're doing a recursive call to every function of lower order terms. So that is something which we will understand shortly. So the recursive step is this. The first is basically you have a base step where you have base conditions or the initial conditions for the smaller problem sizes, right? Where you terminate your recurrence, right? And so you have to keep recursively calling till you reach the base step. From base step, you again keep calling back to reach to your higher step, right? And so what is recursive step is to find new terms from the existing or the preceding terms, the lower order terms. So recurrence compute the next sequence from the k preceding values, right? So recursive relation, recurrence relation is only for the recursive formula that you say, which means it refers to itself, and the argument of the formula must be on the lower values, you know, close to the base values. So based on that, you try to use the recurrence relations that you could use it to solve recursive algorithms. Okay, so let's get on with that. The very first example when I have to explain you a recursive relation or a recurrence relation is to talk about Fibonacci series, correct? You know what your Fibonacci series, right? So how do you represent a Fibonacci series? Now you always have, say, Fibonacci series starting with, say, you have 0, 1. What's the next number in that Fibonacci series? So you take the sum of the two preceding terms and you get the new term. So 0, 1, 1. What's the next one? 1, 1. You go on to add the two preceding terms, you get the next term. And then what's the next term in the Fibonacci series? 1, 2, you add, you're going to get 3. 2 plus 3, it's going to be 5. What's the next term in the series? It's going to be n minus 1 plus n minus 2. So which means it is 8. So this keeps going, right? So now, what do you mean by a recurrence relation? And how do you represent a recurrence relation? Is that you have some base step and you have the recurrence relation up, right? So what's the base step in a Fibonacci series? Now suppose I am representing that as f of n. Now the base steps are this. For n equal to 0 and n equal to 1, you know that f of 0 is 0, f of 1 is 1. So this is the base step. So for n greater than or equal to 2, now I represent the recurrence relation like this. F of n is equal to f of n minus 1 plus f of n minus 2. So my recurrence relation now, that is the recursive formula that I have to calculate what is f of n is going to be equal to f of n minus 1 plus n minus 2. So if I want to calculate what is the Fibonacci series or f of 5, right, I need to know what is the two lower order preceding terms, you know, values in order to calculate the new value. So which means f of 5, if I have to calculate, I should know what is f of 4 plus f of 3. So what is it? What is the value of f of 4 now? Or what is the value of f of 3 now? So which means f of 5 to calculate, I need to know f of 4. I need to calculate f of 3. Right? So prior to calculating f of 5, I should recursively keep dividing this into subproblems and try to solve these subproblems. So if I want to get f of 4, I should calculate what is f of 3 and f of 2. If I want to calculate f of 3, I should calculate what is f of 2 and f of 1. Right? And what is f of 1 and f of 0? F of 1 and f of 0 reaches to the base step. So you get those two values, and now you could calculate what is f of 2. Once you calculated f of 2, for now you have to calculate what is f of 3, which means every time you want to actually find out the value of a higher order term, you have to know the lower order term. But each time you're invoking the same function again and again. So when you're invoking the same function again and again, you're recursive calling the same function again and again, which means that every time you make a call to a lower order function, lower value function, you have to have a return call to back to the main function call, which means the higher order value call. So you use a stack structure here whenever you're doing a recursion, right? So the top value keeps, you keep popping out every time you keep pushing a lower order value term, you keep popping out each time when you completed that, so that you could keep solving this. So anyway, let's get on to you know, this recursive relation. So this is represented by f of n minus 1 plus f of n minus 2, right, till you reach the base case which you have defined, f of 0 and f of. Now let's get on to this. So the recursive step is this. This is how you represent your recursive step, right? So by adding the previous two terms, we get the next order term. So this goes recursively to calculate that. So that's a very, very basic example to start with. What do you mean by a recurrence relation, and how does a recursive formula works? But now let's start writing it in a form of an algorithm, right? What do you mean by a recursive algorithm? What is the main, if you want to calculate the time complexity of this given problem, right, you have to now compute how many times these statements are being computed, right? So what is that operation here that we are doing, which is going to take most of the time? If you look at, is this particular operation where you are trying to multiply and keep calling that same function. So the number of multiplications that you're doing, right, depends on your input size that you have, and based on that is what your order of growth of your algorithm is. Correct? So let's now try to analyze this in the next slide, right, where you want to arrive at the recurrence relation. You generally use the recurrence relations to calculate the time complexity of the algorithm, right? So now the time complexity of the algorithm here is to now calculate the number of multiplication that is required to execute n factorial. Say if I use m of n to calculate the number of multiplications required, right? The initial condition here is this, m of n is equal to 0. What does it mean now? Now for the base case, you're not doing any multiplication, correct? Which means for n equal to 1, if you're doing 1 factorial, you're not going to do any multiplication there because it's a base case. And so the number of multiplication in that scenario is 0. Whereas when you have n greater than 1, where you need to calculate, you will do one multiplication at that time plus fact of recursively with input n minus 1. So you're doing a n into n minus 1, which means you call the fact of n minus 1, correct? So this is the way you're doing. So how many times are you going to do multiplication now? Is you're going to do 1 plus the number of multiplications required for the input size of n minus 1, right? So this is for the recursive case that you have the recurrence relation. The number of multiplications for the base case is 0, right? So each time when you're doing this, so if you want to calculate for m of n, your recurrence relation is 1 plus m of n minus 1. What is m of n minus 1? If you call that, it will again be 1 plus what? M of, what's the next lower order term? It's going to be n minus 2. Instead of n, you substitute n minus 1 now. So it becomes n minus 2. The next time when you do so, it's now going to be 2 plus m minus 2. and then what it becomes? It becomes 3 plus m minus 3, and then it goes on till you reach what? That m minus n minus of, right, n minus 1, it reaches m of 1. Till that you will be doing, which will count you the number of multiplications that is required. So that is the idea behind recurrence relations. You can calculate the count or the number of times in a particular statement, the basic operation which is going to dominate your order of growth of your algorithm, right? And that's the idea behind recurrence relation, where you have to find out what is that operation that is basically trying to dominate your running time of the algorithm. So look at this now. The recurrence relation for factorial computation could be represented like this, right? M of 1 is 0, which means for one value you don't have any multiplications to be performed, but for one you will have to at least do 1 plus m minus n minus 1. So now if you take that in terms of time steps and you say that for the base case, you know, where m of 1 case, you take some time step unit which is b, right? And suppose for doing one multiplication you take some constant time, say c plus, right? You need to know what is for m of n minus 1, right? So when whatever it is, now this b and all that, you see is a constant time o of 1, correct? What you are now interested is in m of n minus 1. So say it takes c times the constant, right? But every time you are repeatedly doing this, how many times it is doing? Now is the question that we will have to start analyzing. So if you look at this case, you know that this x plus 1 is going to be executed n times, right? So I know that the base case is going to take some constant time. This is going to be taking first n time plus, now I'm going to, after that I'm going to call this recursively, and I'm going to solve again it for n by 2 times. So how will I write the recurrence relation for this scenario? Just think of that. Now it's going to be like this, which means you have n steps being performed on the first iteration, and then plus, what's the time taken now to solve the problem of n by 2 steps, right? So your recurrence relation t of n will be n steps plus t of n by 2. And for the base case, where n equal to 1, it's going to take some constant o of 1. Now what is t of n by 2? T of n by 2 meaning now x is going to be done, right, incremented n by 2 times. Correct. So to express this, replace now n by n by 2. So t of n by 2 is now going to be what? Right? Which means the time taken to solve now n by 2 value is going to be, replace n by n by 2, it's going to be t by n by 4 plus what? N by 2. So you can now keep expanding this. If you want to find out what's the time taken for t of n by 2, you have to calculate this. What's the time taken for t of n by 4, you have to again calculate this. So this keeps on, and you can now calculate how much of time it's going to take, you know, for every statement that's going to be repeatedly executed, right, depending upon your input size. And based on that, you could calculate your time complexity of the algorithm, which we will be explaining how to be done. So in this example, if you look at, this is another recurrence relation where you have the base case where if n is equal to 1, right, you're returning a value of 2. Otherwise, now look at this now. This is slightly a different one. Now you have some constant time. 3 times you're doing a multiplication with the f of n by 2 value. But what is the f of n by 2? That's a recursive call again, which I have to calculate, right? Plus, I calculate what's the value of f of n by 2. And then plus doing 5. So in order to calculate this, I need to know what is f of n by 2. What is f of n by 2? Again, you will have to do a 3 times of f of, what is that? N by 4 plus f of n by 4 plus 5. So you'll be keeping doing this. So what's the recurrence relation to represent this is, you know that you're doing a 2 recursive calls. The time taken to solve n by 2, you need to know, do a 2 times of this recursive call so that you could get what is going to be the time taken for that, plus some constant time, right? You're doing some multiplication and all this, that's going to take that, right? For the base case, it's going to be some a time. So it's, this all is O of n, right? What is now important now is, what is this 2 into t of n by 2? So again, it goes recursively, right? So that's the way, this way of recurrence relations are basically being represented. We are only representing recurrence relation in all these algorithms. We will see how to calculate time complexity in the slides to come. Okay. So let's now look at what you mean by recurrences. We understood what you mean by a recurrence relation, right? We have to now use it to calculate the actual running time of the algorithm. First step is to arrive at the algorithm, a recursive algorithm. The next step is to basically write the recurrence relation based on the recursive algorithm. And the third step is to use that recurrence relation to calculate your running time of the algorithm or the time complexity of the algorithm using the recurrence relation. So recurrence relation is basically an equation or inequality that describes a function in terms of its value on smaller inputs. So t of n, if I want to calculate, right, it's going to take n steps plus the time taken to solve t of n minus 1. What is t of n minus 1? You substitute n by n minus 1. It's going to be n minus 1 steps plus t of n minus 2. So this keeps repeatedly going. Right, so that's how the recurrence goes on. But now you have to evaluate based on this recurrence relation what's the time steps taken or the time complexity, right, that we have to do. So how are you going to solve the recurrence? That's the question, and that's the problem that we're going to start doing now, of how to solve the recurrence, right? You're going to find an explicit formula for the expression, right, to solve the recurrence, right? So you have the recurrence relation and you have to solve the recurrence based on that. So that we will look on. So the first way to understand now and solve that, we will start with an algorithm which is called the binary search algorithm. So now that you know what is a linear search algorithm, you now know what's the time complexity of a linear search algorithm. We will start looking at telling you how binary search time complexity is much more better than that of a linear search algorithm. You now know that linear search, in the best case, you could find out in the first iteration itself, right? That's the minimum number of time steps that it takes. And what could be the worst case that it could take? It could take at least n time steps, which means you have to iterate through all the elements in the list, right? Or at the n plus 1, where you go on to say that that element does not match, you slow, go on to n plus 1 is what? The higher order term is n. So it's O of n now. So that is the case for linear search. Can we have a much better algorithm compared to the linear search? The answer is yes, it is possible. And there is another algorithm called binary search, which is what we are going to look at. You know, binary search is basically a recursive algorithm. You know, in binary search, what are you going to do here is, you're not basically going to iterate through all the elements in the list. The only condition that you need for the binary search to be performed is that the element should be sorted. Right. So if you have a sorted list and you want to search an element in that list, binary search is going to simplify the way that you're going to search by adopting what? A recursive algorithm. Right. So if you look at this algorithm, it's quite simple. But let me first explain you the algorithm. So the idea here is this: binary search, what does it do is, you want to search, say, an element, say 5, right, in the list. Instead of iteratively going through this, it's a non-recursive algorithm. You're now basically going to divide this problem into two halves, right? It's like a decrease and conquer approach that you're doing, right? Which means that I'm not going to iterate the entire list. What I'm instead going to do is, among these two halves that I have, I choose a middle element, right? Say I choose 7 as the element, and then compare that search element 5 with 7, right? If the search element 5 is lesser than the mid element, then I only start iterating through the first subproblem and I will skip the second subproblem, which means I'm not going to iterate through the entire list. You get the idea? Since the search element is less than the mid element, what you now do is you have to iterate the first subproblem and not the second subproblem. Now, further that, I need to do this. So what I do now is I further divide this subproblem of size 4 into two more sizes. Right, which means I take the mid value now and say the mid value is now is 5 itself. Right, you go on to now compare 5 with 5 and you found out that the 5 is there in the other half. And you stop the algorithm, which means you have a problem of size n. You now divided, decreased it to n by 2, and then you decreased it further to n by 4, and you went on doing which means that you are not going on to iterating all the elements there. You are now reducing the number of steps to solve the problem. So let's try to understand the algorithm firstly, of the binary search, where there are multiple inputs to the algorithm. So you need to be aware that this is an ordered array, which means it is sorted. So A is the array which holds all the elements. There is an index variable low, there is an index variable I, and you want to find whether X, the element value stored in X, does it exist in the array A. This is the algorithm. But this is basically a recursive function, which means you're going to recursively keep calling this. Okay. So if you look at here, your base case, when will you terminate, is you're going to search an element whether it is there or not, correct? And for that, I don't want O of N, I want a lesser number of iterations, even in the worst case, right? So that is what you're focusing here. And so when you're doing this decrease and conquer approach, right, or a recursive approach that you're doing, your base case is this. You're checking each time your low index value and high index value is going to be changed. Because what does the initial case of the low value and the high value will be? Low value will be index 1 and the I value will be index 8, which means that you have 8 elements, right? What is the low value containing? It's containing the index lower index value. The high is containing the higher index value. So now what happens is that first time, every time when you're checking, right, you're only going to check half of the problem, right? You're reducing the problem size. And then you're trying to do. You will keep repeating this when a case arises where the low index value goes on to become larger than the high index value, which means you have reduced the subproblems further. And now if you proceed with the next iteration, your index value, now low value, will become greater than high, and so you can't do your iterations further there. So that's a stopping case where you don't find the element, and so you return false, which means that you don't have the element in that list. But now let's look at the case where you're finding out the element, or how you're going to recursively solve this. Now when you know the index value, you want to get the mid value, right? How will you get the mid value? Only when you know what's the low index value and the high index value, right? So how are you calculating the mid value? The mid value is based on the low index value and the high index value. So you sum these two index value and divide by 2, you will get your mid value. So now why am I taking that mid value? Because you want to compare your search element X, whether it is equal to the mid value, right? If it's equal to the mid value, what does it mean? X is equal to A of mid, which means you know what's the index value of mid now. You see that the search match, which means the element matches at the iteration, you return true, which means the element is there. Or there could be two other cases, which means if the search element value is less than the mid value, the search, or if the search element value is greater than the mid value, which means what? You have to understand whether your search element is going to be lesser than this in this sub half or in this particular half of the problem. So you now have a bigger problem. You're now looking at finding out the mid element and searching the element whether it lies in the lower half or the upper half of the, you know, problem size that you have. So if it's X is less than A of mid, which means that if 5 is less than 7, then what you do? You go on to invoke again the same function recursively, but this time please look at this. Now what are you passing now is that you're passing the array, right? You're passing the low index value. But the high value now is changed to mid minus 1, right? Mid minus 1. The high value now is going to be, what is mid minus 1? The mid value, say, is going to be 4, right? You're only going to keep searching from 2, 3, 5. So 1, 2, 3 is what is going to be okay. So mid minus 1 is basically 3. So you now have reduced your problem that's coming in now. So that is the idea that you're trying to do, right? Otherwise, what will be the case? Suppose if X is greater than A of mid, what does it mean? It's going to be in the other half. Then what is going to be changed? The low index value is not going to be 1 now. It has to be 5 now. So your low value becomes mid plus 1. Your high value retains like that. So depending upon whether your search element is in this half or that half, and you keep recursively doing this, right? You could go on to recursively call your function with lower order till you have found the element. Either you have found the element or you've reached the case where that element is not in that particular list. So that's the case you're trying to do. So here, when you do a low plus high by 2, in our case, what happened? 1 plus 8 by 2, when you're doing for the first iteration, it will be 9 by 2. So when you have 9 by 2, when you divide that, it's 4.5, which means either I should take 4 or 5, right? Index value is not in terms of decimal, right? So what we're doing here is, you know this symbol, right? This symbol is basically called as the flow, you know, seal, which means you actually go on to round off to the previous value. So when you have 9/2 is 4.5, you take it as index 4. So this is the way that we're doing. So which means that you take mid value as 4 and then you start. So that's the way that you're doing recursively, and then you're trying to solve this. This is a recursive algorithm in order to search the element where you decrease the problem size and you find out whether the particular search element is there. Now let's see how you arrive at the recurrence relation for this particular recursive algorithm. Right, so this is the explanation of what I've been explaining. Now you want to search for the element 7 in that this particular list. I will give this as an example. Just try it out. The PPT is loaded, so you in Moodle, so you could go and just try and see your understanding of how this particular algorithm works. But now let's try to arrive at how the recurrence relation is being arrived for this particular. Okay, this is still the continuation of that. For the next subsequent cases, still you search the element. Okay, another example for the same particular case. Now let us arrive at this. How are you coming up with the recursive relation for that? This is going to be quite interesting. Now let's see what are you doing here. Now you're calling this, you want to calculate, right, what is the time taken, right, for an input of size n, right? That's what we want to calculate, the running time of an array of size n, of a of n that you have. We have to calculate this. So how are we doing this? Now this particular step takes a constant time, right, o of n, right? This is also going to take o of 1, right? This is also going to take some constant time. What is that going to take some time here? Is this recursive call that comes up? How many times this recursive call is going to be done? So either this will be called or this will be called, correct? So you're doing some constant number of steps plus the time taken to solve the problem of, when you're doing it for n, what did you do for the next time? You divided that into two parts, right? So it's going to be n/2. So you're decreasing and contouring it, right? So it's going to be t of n is equal to c plus t of n/2. What is c of t plus n/2, t of n/2? It will again take some constant time. It has to execute all this and find out whether it is going to do that, right? So that is going to take, n now becomes n/2. So it becomes t of n/4. So you have to find what's the time taken for t of n/4. So you'll keep doing this, right? And then use that recurrence relation to calculate what is the time complexity of the binary search algorithm, which we will try to solve. Okay, so this is now coming to the, you know, actual case. Now that you know what a recursive algorithm is, right, how to write a recursive algorithm, right, and based on the recursive algorithm, how do you actually arrive at the recurrence relation, depending upon the number of time steps that's been doing, whether these are doing constant time, what's a recursive call, how much time that it takes for the recursive call with the lower order inputs, that recurrence relation you're able to arrive. Now how are you going to solve that recurrence relation in order to get your time complexity? There are four different methods involved. So you can note down this, or you could take that into a mind. So today we will just look at the iteration method and stop the class. So there is this method called iteration method, which is quite a simpler method where you're going to expand the recurrence relation and do some kind of an arithmetic series, a geometric series. So it's like you're unrolling the recurrence relation, expanding that recurrence relation till the lower order term comes in, and sum up all that and calculate what is the time complexity by using some arithmetic series or, you know, geometric series. The other one is called the substitution method, which uses a principle called mathematical induction. The third one is called recursion tree method, which is a graphical representation method to solve and obtain the time complexity. And the master's method is something like a cookbook. You have some rules, right? If this falls under this case, then this is going to be the time complexity. So there's a formula to do that, which will be the last way to solve recurrence relation. So getting into it, our focus today is only on the iteration method, right? In the iteration method, you're converting the recurrence into a summation series, and then you go on to bound the summation series with using some series formulas in order to calculate the time complexity of it. In the substitution method, you're basically going to guess, okay, come on here, I'm going to use guess that, okay, this is going to be the asymptotic bound at the time complexity, and use this principle of mathematical induction to prove your guess is right. I would not recommend this particular approach. We would rather try to focus on iteration method. Master book is a very tested method for determining asymptotic solutions. You could also use a much graphical representation called recursive tree, which is much simpler, since you're graphically dealing with how much of iterations is being done, right? So the recursive tree method is basically a graphical depiction of the entire set of recursive invocations, right, to obtain and guess your solution that comes in either through substitution and all that. But anyway, let's look at these methods later, including the master's book, which is a cookbook method, which means it's a rule book where you go on to see what's the rule that matches, and then accordingly from that rule, whatever is the formula told, you use that to calculate your asymptotic time complexity. Let's now look at the iteration method, where you're trying to convert the recurrence into a summation series and trying to bound it by using some known series formula. Not sure whether you're aware of, you're able to recollect the arithmetic series formula, the geometric series formulas, and all the summation series, so that you can start using that to calculate what is the time complexity of that. So let's iterate the recurrence till the initial condition is reached, right? That's what you're going to do. So how do you do that? Let's look at some problems. Based on the recurrence relation we have been doing so far, we will try to arrive at that. So the first problem that we did, right, we wanted to do the factorial, and I came up with this telling that how many multiplications you're doing, how many times you're trying to do the multiplication or the recursive step. Now you have to calculate the time complexity of the factorial algorithm. How will you do that? Let's use the first method. What is that method called? That method is called iteration method. So how are you going to do now is, you have this particular equation, sir. What do you do with this equation, right? You have to calculate the time complexity. So what you do now is, the first step is going to be this. Take the recursive step, C plus M of N minus 1. What is M of N minus 1? You have to expand M of N minus 1. So instead of N, you put N minus 1, right? And keep doing this. Constant is a constant. It takes some constant time to do that. Plus, you have to calculate what is, so this expansion goes like this, C plus M of N minus 2. Now the next question is this, what is M of N minus 2? That's going to be C plus M of N minus 3. So you keep doing this. How long will you keep doing this? Till you reach your base step. When will you reach your base step? When you reach where your N minus of N minus 1 that you do, you reach to your base step, which is M of N. Right? So you're going to do this for N minus 1 times. You're adding this N minus 1 times to reach to M of 1. What is M of 1? M of 1 is some constant B, which is O of N. Right? But the number of C's that you see here is N minus 1 times that constant times step, plus you have some constant time step. So I told you that we have to ignore the lower order terms and all that, right? So what are we interested here is to know that this order of growth is a linear order of growth, which is O of N. As simple as that. So iteration method is all about expanding the recurrence relation till you reach your base step, so that you could go on to do some summation series. Now in this case, it's a simple constant. So you just add that, you sum that N minus 1 times C, right, in order to calculate what's the time complexity in terms of the number of steps. Now let's look at binary search, right? We arrived at a recurrence relation T of N is equal to C plus T of N minus 2. What is the time complexity of this? How will you solve this? Let's use the iteration method again. So when you use the iteration method again, you have to expand the. So C plus T of N by 2, what's the next step? What is T of N by 2? Instead of N, you substitute N by 2. So it becomes now constant C plus T of N by 4. What is T of N by 4? It becomes C plus T of N by 8. How long will you keep doing this? Till you reach T of 1. So what does it mean now? So how many times are you doing this? You are dividing the problem, right, of two order. You are decreasing it, right? That's the way you are doing. So you are dividing it 2. So 2 becomes 4, 4 becomes 8 and all that. So it is of the 2 to the power of some k steps, correct? So the idea here is, n is basically 2 to the power of k times, which means that you are doing this k times. So n becomes n by 2, n by 2 now becomes n by 4, n by 4 becomes n by 8 and all this, which means, say if your problem is of size 8, right, first time you divided it became 4, and then in that 4 you started to find out 2, only 2, in that you went down only with 1. So how many iterations you're doing here, right, is only k iterations you're doing, k times you're doing. What is k now? Now k is basically 2 to the power of k, which means that in this case, if your value of n is 8, you're only dividing it, 8 became 4, 4 became 2, 2 became 1. So you only had 3 iterations coming in, right? So how many times that it comes in, assume that if you say n is equal to 2 power k, right? Now you had n is equal to 8, right? So that is of some 2 to the power of 3. So you keep decreasing the problem, you know, 3 times, right? And further to reach till the base case that's coming in, which means that t of n by 8 in that case, so c, you're doing k times plus t of 1 is the base case that comes in. So that's the worst case, which means that you have reached and you still have not found, right? So c of k times, what is the value of k? That in relation to n is what you have to represent. You know that n is equal to 2 to the power of k. What is k? K is basically, what is it? N is equal to 2 power k. K will be log to the base 2k. So what is the time complexity of the algorithm? This is a constant. So it becomes c into k. K is log 2n. Your time complexity of the algorithm is logarithmic. So if you have a problem of size n, which is equal to 8, you're not iterating for 8 times, but you're iterating out only for 3 times. Right, and then you're able to find that. In the worst case, you're able to do that. So you reduce the number of iterations in the realm of logarithmic order. So that is the beauty here. So how did it become n t equal to 1 in the worst case is this. Now you go on till n by 2 power k, right? So what happens is this becomes t of 1, right? And so the k is basically log of n. So that's the way you solve problems in recurrence relations using iteration method, in order to expand that series, right, and then use some series formulas to basically calculate the complexity of the algorithm, right? You could use that for the asymptotic upper bound or the O notation to calculate that, right? Recap the arithmetic series formula and then expand that recurrence relation and apply this arithmetic series to arrive at what is going to be the time complexity of the algorithm. Is it okay? So take this problem, apply iteration method, take this recurrence relation, keep expanding this till you reach the base case. You will be in a situation where you could apply arithmetic series, the geometric series, and that's how it goes. And then try to see what is going to be the time complexity of that algorithm. This is what you are basically going to do it as an exercise. But you could always refer to the solution of this problem in this slide to understand how it has been done, so that you're quite comfortable with solving recurrence relation. And the method that you're using to solve is what? It's called the iteration method. Okay? So just try out using this. We should also learn problems on logarithmic formulas. You have to recap that also, because we'll be using those logarithmic formulas like quotient rule, property rule and all this. So I have the list of logarithmic formula also given in the subsequent slides, so you could refer that and try to solve the problem. Okay, so that is the idea behind this entire lecture. So we will stop the class with this, right? So there are a lot of such recurrence relations that you can go on to do, right? And then you can try to apply iteration method to solve and obtain the time complexity of a given problem. So please try out only for that problem and see if you could extend to these example recurrence relation and make yourself comfortable. We will meet in the next class, but please ping me whether you have done that, you know, so that you're quite comfortable working on solving recurrences using iteration method. Okay. this particular slide revisits all the logarithmic formula. All this you should be aware of. You could just recap this and see if necessary you can apply starting this logarithmic formula, right? So please try that problem, right? And thank you so much for listening. Just ping me once you have done the problem. Okay, thanks. Yeah.